Hello, everybody. Welcome back to Holly Randall Unfiltered, coming to you from the void. Yes, I am in my new daylight studio. A lot of you guys know that I moved recently and I'm still struggling to find a good place to record this podcast. So that's why I'm in like a different area every time I do this. So now I'm in my new studio. Excuse me for the floor being so dirty. I didn't get a chance to paint the cyclorama wall last night, but we're not here to talk about where I'm at. We're here to talk about where the future of sex technology is at. Yes, today we are going to talk about sex robots. Are they actually a thing? Like, how far are we away from a Westworld-like world? And what does sex robots mean for relationships? Could they actually be good for humanity? What are the ethical concerns around sex robots? We've got Eleanor Hancock here today, sex tech researcher, who's going to tell us all about the future of intimacy. Eleanor, thank you so much for joining us today.
No worries. It's a pleasure.
So, Eleanor, tell us, I guess, a little bit about how you got started in this field.
Okay. Yeah, when anyone ever asks me this, it's like, okay, wow, like, have you got 10 minutes? Let me sit you down.
We've got an hour, actually.
Yeah, no. So we're going to get through this. So, right, basically, when I was at university, I was working at a homeless shelter. I was volunteering, so I had a lot of close proximity with sex workers. They did obviously tend to be more like outdoor-based sex workers, street-based sex workers, but, you know, a lot of them had had experiences in other areas of the adult industry prior to coming to us at a homeless shelter. So I was sort of exposed to, yeah, like that, you know, a lot of people involved in that world. And then at university, I had like an essay that I was meant to complete. And it was about like the future of intimacy with technology. So obviously, I think that for the past few years now, the blend between technology and sexuality and our phones and our relationships and the way we talk and communicate has just been, you know, getting more and more embedded with each other. So I chose to write about the future sex industry, and I focused a lot of it on sex robots because at the time I'd come across a book by David Levy, and it was called Love and Sex with Robots. And he basically made an argument that by 2050, sex robots would be in the sex industry, sex robots would be, you know, really working their way into our homes. But the conversations I had with sex workers sort of, I don't know, they didn't really make me agree with him, to be honest with you. So I put it all into like an essay, and I basically sort of accentuated the idea that the jobs that sex workers do aren't just replaceable by technology. Yeah, and then it ended up like, you know, picking up a bit of momentum, and I actually went to debate with David Levy at the British Academy. So yeah, and then I also became involved with the campaign against sex robots as well, which is sort of the polar opposite of David, and it's sort of trying to teach society about the dangers of sex robots. So I spent a bit of time on both sides.
It's so interesting to me that there is actually like an organized campaign against sex robots, that like the fact that they are so already, you know, in a position that we need to like campaign against them. I mean, where exactly are we on the sex robots trajectory? Like, because there aren't robots that you can have sex with yet, right? Like, we have what I found, I learned a new word yesterday researching you, which I was really excited about, dildotronic devices. And that just means like dildos that are activated by technology, right? Like the internet, yeah. You can kind of talk like, I love that word, dildotronic. I don't know. It's like my favorite new word. But yeah, where are we exactly in that whole field? How far have sex robots come?
Not far really. And this was something that became quite evident to me after I wrote that essay and really started researching sex robots. You know, like I was contacting people that were like opening pop-up brothels, you know, I was trying to get in touch with people that were presenting these sex robots on, you know, television and things. And it was really evident to me that they weren't robots. They were, you know, at best sort of dolls with an animatronic capability of some sort. You know, it could move its head, have a mouth that, you know, but it wasn't anything fully fledged. You know, it wasn't anything like that we see in TV programs. You know, we've had quite a few, you know, like Westworld, and we had Humans on Channel 4 in the UK. I'm not sure if it's available in the US as well. But yeah, we are so, so far away from that yet, which is sort of why I then started looking at other things like, you know, dildotronics. There's also a word called teledildonics. I'm not sure if you've heard of that. But yeah, I think that teledildonics, dildotronics, they all sort of fall under the sex tech umbrella. And for me, I was sort of thinking like, wow, you know, I'm here and I'm writing essays about sex robots, but actually there's other stuff expanding in the world that's having more of an impact on sexuality because they're more accessible. I think that even, you know, sex dolls with a small, you know, animatronic capability to move, it's not advanced, you know. There's probably less technology in it than the Hoover. So for me, it's not really a sex robot revelation yet.
So then why is there an organized group against sex robots if it hasn't really come that far? What do you think the fear is behind that organization?
Well, for me, when I first, you know, linked in with the organization, I did see a lot of importance in the points because they did focus on the objectification of women. I believe in equality for both sexes. So, of course, some of that narrative really struck a chord with me, because I do think that just like we see sort of a bit of a backlash with pornography at the moment in the way that some people, you know, a lot of viewers are getting fed up with that sort of sanitized, over-the-top representation of humans within pornography. And I can understand why people wouldn't want the same with sex robots, because it's unrealistic, right? So I guess because that struck a chord with me, I was able to sort of see why such a campaign might exist. But the more I became involved, the more I saw that actually what the campaign's problem was to me was with sex work and capitalism, you know, and not actually sex robots. I mean, don't get me wrong. I think the objectification of any human being is wrong. But I think that unless you tackle that with humans, it doesn't make sense to just go heads first and start it with robots first. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. I mean, on one hand, I almost feel like perhaps those who are against the objectification of women might welcome sex robots, because then you're objectifying a robot and not a human being. And, you know, there's the possibility down the line to remove human beings from sex work. But on the other hand, perhaps it's more along the lines of just another representation of the way that women are objectified, because these sex robots are going to look like women, right? They're going to be built like women. They're going to sound like women. They're going to, you know, basically be animatronic women.
Of course. But then this was another real big point, revelation, if you will. But, you know, there was a couple of nights where I was sat there, I was researching and, you know, I was writing things about sex robots. And I sort of thought, well, actually, who is going to say that they even look human? You know, like who they might not. I mean, if you ask a lot of people out there what their sort of sexual tastes and preferences are, and if you gave them the opportunity to really experiment and build something, you know, that from their wildest fantasies, it might not be a human. It might not look like a human. It could look like an avatar. It could look like a Pokemon. Like, honestly, I mean, I think that the sort of abundance of sex toys out there shows us the wider taste of sort of aesthetics that we have in sex. I mean, like, I don't know if you've heard of like the Dragon Dildo brand. There's been Pokemon dildos. And I think that there's a real appetite for different looking people, if you will. You know, like, I think that we've got massive communities of like anime, don't we? Anime and sort of fantasy. And I think that, you know, sex robots would really give those people like a chance to experiment and explore. And for me, it was like, well, that argument is totally gone. You know, if a sex robot doesn't look like a human, who is it objectifying? And, you know, for me, I don't really think the campaign became that justified when I considered all those other points. And also, it didn't talk about the objectification of men, which is a real, real thing as well. I mean, if you speak to a lot of men about their porn viewing habits, a lot of guys, a lot of my friends have said to me, you know, to be honest, some porn isn't doing it for me anymore because, you know, some of the body parts are all just so unrealistic. You know, it's not portraying real sex all the time. You know, everyone's got a massive knob, massive boobs. And it doesn't always make people feel great. I guess people, you know, are vulnerable nowadays. We're just sort of bombarded, aren't we, with so many different body types. I guess it doesn't always sit well with people. So for me, that ignoring men in the campaign was, yeah, it was wrong. It was wrong.
You know, that's really interesting that you brought that point up, because that is something that I always mention when I kind of talk about or argue against the idea that like porn is degrading to women, because the subject is always women, right? Like we never talk about, is porn degrading to men? We never talk about the male porn stars as victims. We always talk about the female porn stars as victims. And for me, the fact that like you're always casting women in this victim role automatically, you know, and this is generally from people who don't talk to sex positive sex workers. I mean, look, obviously, there's always going to be sex workers who are going to have a bad experience in the adult industry. That's inevitable. But there's also a lot of people who have a really great experience, and women who feel empowered by shooting porn, and who, especially nowadays, you know, with the rise of OnlyFans and everything, women that are like become incredibly financially independent to the point that they're not even working for other production companies anymore. They're only creating their own content. So like, porn itself has changed so much in terms of the dynamic between like producers and brands and companies and the performer. But yeah, going back to what you just talked about, it's always about like the women is the victim. Like, you know, you never hear about the men. And so, you know, I wonder then if, like you said, that these future sex robots may not always look like people. And then you're like, okay, well then who is it objectifying? Is then the fear with sex robots having to do more around the fear around sex or the fear around intimacy and human communication? I mean, we're already seeing, you know, problems with, you know, the rise of the internet, with social media, where people are starting to feel disconnected from each other. And I can imagine that people fear that that will take, you know, even more, that will become even more of a problem if we start to introduce technology into our sex lives.
So I can totally see the concerns that people have about introducing technology into the bedrooms and what sort of impact this might have for us as individuals. But I think that ever since we've started using technology more, there's also always been a bit of a fear around it. There's been this fear that, all right, okay, if you've got 1,000 Facebook friends, it's because you don't talk to anybody in real life and you don't have time for anybody. But actually, research suggests that the more people you know in real life, the more you will interact on social media. And I actually can sort of see that with sex tech as well, in that, you know, the more adventurous you are with your partner in real life or your partners, the more likely you might be to use sex tech on an interactive sort of scale. I don't see any sort of empirical research as of yet that suggests the increase of sex tech reduces the physical sex that you have in real life. I actually think that it's a really great way to practice, to be honest with you. You know, if you're someone that's a bit shy in bed, or a bit shy about learning about your body, about masturbation, about trying things out, connecting a sex toy with somebody that you've never met before in a remote setting that's totally secure, so totally private, is actually quite revolutionary. And, you know, it gives you that chance on your own to try things out. And hey, if you don't like it, you can disconnect. It's not like, you know, you're on a date and it's like you texted your friend, like, you know, help me get out of here. And you know, you don't have to worry about things like that. And yeah, I think that's really quite cool.
You know, actually, that reminds me of something that I think a lot of us don't necessarily consider, people especially who are against, you know, the capitalization of sex. Is I had a member of my Patreon who mentioned that, you know, he's handicapped and he was kind of arguing for the need for sex workers in a kind of therapeutic and sexual way, because he said, look, you know, I'm handicapped. He said, I don't get to like date. Like, women are generally not interested in me. It is very difficult for me to find somebody who wants to have sex with me. So for me to be able to go and pay somebody for the kind of intimacy that I can't get in real life is really important to me. And, you know, and he's got his regular women that he sees and they've developed a relationship. And a lot of sex workers that I've spoken to, you know, who escort or work in brothels have talked about how a lot of times the guys that come in to see them are looking for more than just sex. They're looking for companionship as well. And it was, you know, I think that we often forget about like that kind of sect of people who have a really hard time dating and who have a really hard time meeting women and may not be having sex if they didn't have the ability to pay somebody to deliver that service to them. You know, we always think about how it might be, you know, ruining relationships with married men or something. You hear that a lot. So, I could see how sex robots could help even more in that area with those people who have a hard time connecting with people in real life.
I totally agree with that point. And back when I started all this, I was interviewing sex workers that I knew in a street-based setting. But then I branched out I looked in a few different places, actually. So there's a huge site called Adult Work. It's really popular in England to sell sexual services. We also have Beaver Street, Gumtree, which is a bit like Craigslist for you guys. And I just sort of actually contacted people, sex workers on there, and just asked if they'd be interested in having either a phone conversation with me. And once I sort of had a relationship with some of them on the phone, I met with them in person to conduct interviews. And I did speak to a few that had a lot of disabled clients. And obviously that was, you know, one of the first things I thought of too, the idea that, you know, could sex robots potentially offer a better service? Or, you know, because would a sex robot be able to have more strength than a human sex worker, you know, because sometimes there might be lifting involved in a client that perhaps has limited mobility, et cetera, et cetera. Sometimes clients have like involuntary movements. Like, I've spoke to one sex worker who used to come back quite bruised after seeing one particular client. And it wasn't anything that this client had done on purpose. It was just part of the illness he was living with, where there was a lot of involuntary movements. And that was something that she took in her stride. But obviously, in an ideal world, would it be better if we could, if a sex robot would be able to sort of go through those motions? And I actually brought this up at a conference once about the idea that, you know, to build the ultimate sex robot, you would need to really start linking in with sex workers and speak to them. And I'll never forget it. One of the guys on the panel just sort of turned around and was like, we don't need to talk to sex workers to build the ultimate sex robot. And it was just sort of from that moment, I was a bit like, okay, wow, I'm actually really glad that I'm here. And I can bring their views forward. And, you know, any opportunity I would have to introduce sex workers into a sphere of development and design, I would do it at a heartbeat, because I think that they have so, so much qualitative and contextual knowledge that, you know, designers and developers would just perhaps never think about. And I think that, you know, people don't speak enough about these, you know, sectors of people that don't have access to sex and are reliant on sex workers. For us to have a future where sex robots perhaps can participate in that, we do need that conversation, because so many people are reliant on those services, not even people just with physical disabilities, people living with emotional difficulties that makes it hard for them to sustain a relationship, you know, for long periods of time. So, but again, as well, another thing that struck me about all that was that, you know, I thought it was such a brilliant, you know, concept, but it was like, wow, you know, we're so far away from that sex robot future yet. Which was again why I was really quite keen to come to sex technology, because that is happening right now. And I think that has a potential for anybody that is struggling with sex for whatever reason right now. I think it can really help. And that's one thing I'm actually doing currently at the moment. That's one of my projects. I'm always, you know, trying to talk to anybody living with a disability about how, you know, any products might be able to help them.
Yeah, no, that's a great point. The idea that, you know, being able to build like the perfect sex robot that could have the strength, like you said, to kind of move and manage people with disabilities. And, you know, perhaps some people might be more comfortable knowing that it wasn't like a real human that they are engaging with, not somebody who's going to judge them, you know, make them feel less than. That actually brings me to another question. Could, because I was looking at the links you sent me, and I was looking up some kind of questions that people were kind of throwing around about sex robots. And could sex robots be introduced in a way where they could help one partner's with sexual release and the other partner wouldn't feel jealous because it's not a human being?
I think what the issue is with sex robots is because they resemble humans, it's a word called anthropomorphism, where basically we give sort of human qualities to things that resemble humans. So like, you know, just a simple example of that is, do you remember like years and years ago, everyone had the little Tamagotchis, didn't they? You know, the little, just like the little, it was like a little gadget you kept in your pocket, and it was like a little pixelated animal that you looked after. But people became insane, you know, over these caring for their Tamagotchis, because we, you know, the idea of that Tamagotchi was that it had sort of not human emotions, but it resembled like humanity to us. And you know, if you look at the way sometimes people relate to toys, you know, relate to animals, I think that we really, once we see that resemblance in a human, it taps into our emotions in a different way. So for me, I feel like it's such a personal thing that it will always be quite difficult, I think, to bring another, you know, human-like entity into a relationship where there are just so many different complex emotions. But again, this is what really inspired me about sex tech, because obviously they don't resemble humans. I mean, I have the key on here. This is one of the sex tech devices that Kiro make. But obviously this isn't really going to arouse any sort of jealousy, I don't think. I mean, I personally wouldn't be jealous of that, in the sense that, you know, it doesn't look like a human. It doesn't act like a human. You know, it's something that, you know, once it's used, it goes in a box under the bed, you know, under the bed in your little drawer. Whereas I think that, you know, once it's a robot, it has a presence in the room. For me personally, I'm actually really open-minded. I would probably have a threesome with a sex robot, but I really do understand those feelings about that. I actually, as well, I write poems as a hobby. I've always loved creative writing, and because of like my experience in this industry and, you know, my research with sex robots, I have started like a series writing poems about like the future of sex toys and robots. And one of my poems is actually about the three-way relationship between a robot, and it's trying to address those concerns, you know, a robot can be turned off, you know, it's never going to tell you not to do the dishes or come home, and you know, you're only having one pint at the pub and then you're back here, you know, you're not going to get all that. But again, what you won't get is, you know, it's not a human. It's not a human. And I think that deep down, all of us want to be, you know, loved, and we want to love, and we want to love in return. And I think that we know that that is a human thing. So I personally wouldn't be so sure that just because a robot, you know, walks and talks and looks like us, we would be so quick to throw everything to it. I mean, it's like the Kindle thing, isn't it? I think when the Kindle came out and everyone was reading online, everyone was like, oh my God, books are going to be gone within a year. We're never going to read again. But actually, they haven't lost their place in society. And I really sort of hope that we see the same with sex robots in the future and with sex tech. You know, it's not a replacement. It's something to accompany your experience. It's something to help educate you. It's not a replacement of human physical contact full stop at all. And nor does it ever try to be. So, yeah.
Do you think that sex robots could be programmed in a way where they could learn? They could learn people's preferences. They could learn, you know, how to masturbate you in a way where, you know, how like, you know, some guys like it hard, some guys like it soft, like every guy's kind of different. Would sex robots be able to learn your preferences?
Well, yeah, I think that obviously machine learning would make that possible. But I think that this was, you know, one of my considerations when I looked at, you know, the context of sex robots in brothels and things like that. You know, how would it's like, for example, you know, there was a Microsoft chatbot that went on Twitter, and the idea was that, you know, it used deep learning to sort of learn, you know, learn and interact with people. But obviously, you know what Twitter's like, it's, you know, a bit of a cesspit, isn't it? So within an hour of being on there and learning from humans, it turned racist, it turned homophobic, it took that to take it down. And I remember seeing that, and I remember thinking, what would a sex robot learn in a brothel, really? What would it learn? You know, and that would be totally, you know, unfiltered, you know, because unless you're going to have somebody watching in the room every time somebody sleeps with this sex robot to check that it's all PC or whatever, it would be quite difficult, wouldn't it? So, yeah, I mean, I think that for me, it would be much easier for a robot to do that in a personalized setting because, you know, it can learn your settings the same way your computer does. You know, it can ask you, you can set things up. So I think it will be possible, but it's a long way away yet, a long way away yet.
Right. All right, guys, we're going to take a commercial break and we'll be right back. So hang tight.
If you're here, it's probably because you're a fan of my podcast, Holly Randall Unfiltered. Well, that's great because I'm a fan of my podcast too. Now, if you don't know what Patreon is, it's a crowdfunding platform that allows people to make contributions on a monthly basis. Because this podcast costs money to make, maybe even more so than others. I'm obsessed with quality. So since the beginning, I have always recorded in a studio, had a professional sound engineer, and recorded professional video. All of these things cost money, as you can imagine. And I also made a pretty scary decision this year to cut down on my directing gigs so that I could focus more on this podcast, which is why I need your help now more than ever. But don't worry, I'm not asking you to give me something for nothing. In exchange for your contributions, I offer so many perks. For example, access to the live streams of all of my interviews, a bonus podcast that I do called My LA Porn Life, Q&As where the stars answer your specific questions, behind-the-scenes interviews, merchandise such as mugs, shirts, and stickers, access to my private Snapchat, and so much more. You can join for as little as $5 a month and help me change the way the world sees the adult industry and sex work. So take a look around and see everything that I have to offer. I really hope that you'll join and be a part of our little community.
All right, so we are back. So Eleanor, tell us a little bit about your work currently in the dildotronic industry. Would that be the right way to describe it?
Yes. Well, you love that word, so I'll let you have that one.
I love that word.
Use it as much as you can. So at the moment, I work for Kiro. I've worked at Kiro for just over 2 years now. Which feels crazy with everything going on with COVID and everything. You know, everyone's been here, there, and everywhere. I was working with them in Amsterdam, but now I'm back in England just because of COVID. And I work like as a freelancer, but you know, when the flights are up and running again, I'll be over there regularly. So I work as a researcher for Kiro. So I do some stuff obviously to do with like product feedback and making sure things are good in that sense. And then I also have been helping with our recent Feel Star campaign. So we released a collection of strokers that were all models on porn stars. So we have Natalia Stars here, just so you can see it. Can you see that? Yeah, there you can now. So yeah, that's what I'm working on right now. Yeah, it's been really exciting. And we're literally just sort of in the middle of the launches now. So yeah, it's been a really exciting process.
So tell me a little bit about what these do. Like, how are they dildotronic?
Okay, so basically, our toys, so this is the Keon, which is our male masturbator. And basically this can be connected up with interactive porn. It can be connected with another one of our corresponding toys, the Pill 2. So you can, anything, any movement that is on the Pill 2 will then go onto the Keon as well. So it can give you like a virtual sex experience. Obviously the Keon can also just be connected up one way. So it connects up with interactive webcam shows, VR pornography, sort of 2D pornography, but that the movements on screen are then synced with your toy. So it's like you're having like an immersive experience with, wow, with the toy.
Is there a way for two people who are maybe like long distance lovers to interact with each other through that?
Yes, yes. So essentially you would have anybody with a penis would be able to use the Keon. And then anybody with a vagina, vulva, would use the corresponding female toy. And they could both be connected. So anything, yeah, so any of the movements that go on the G-spot vibrator would then sync onto the Keon as well. And the Keon would move up and down on one's penis in the same sort of movements. So yeah, that gives like a bit of a virtual experience. And I mean, all of this is controlled on an app as well, on our Feel Connect app. So for example, as well, you know, if you want to pleasure your partner and they're all the way across the world from you, you could connect the control the movements of the toy on the app. So yeah, it's exciting. I mean, I've connected quite a lot of times online. Just, I know I say it's for research purposes, but you know, sometimes I am... Sometimes it's a bit of both, I'm not going to lie to you. And it is really, really, it is really exciting. It really is. Yeah, and you can definitely, you know, it's, I think that it's very much something that obviously appeals to couples. But as I said, that there's a real appetite out there. And I think especially during the lockdown, for people to connect with anybody. And I think that's really fun. And I mean, I always see on our Reddit, you know, people are like looking for partners, like, you know, hey, I've got the Pill 2, I want to connect. Or, hey, I've got the key on, you know, who's available tonight to connect with me and control it. And I think that's really, really cool. Yeah, I'm always like upvoting those posts, trying to help them find a remote partner.
I wonder if anybody's actually like done that and then ended up dating in real life, like met through those channels.
That would be really cool. I think that it... I wouldn't be surprised. I really, really wouldn't be surprised. I know that out of the people that I've spoke to, because obviously I just look for feedback as well sometimes on the app and how this, you know, the movements and the syncing has been for people. And I also, you know, I like to hear how positive or negative their experience was. And what I get is quite a common thing is that, all right, they're not necessary. It's not a love story, but you make a lot of friends on it. Genuinely, you make friends and you learn a lot from people. And I think that's really, really nice. Like I spoke to one guy once who was sort of saying that what his taste, the partner he'd partnered up with sort of was after things that didn't turn him on. And he was like, hey, actually, you know, I know another guy on here that would love to do that for you. So I just feel like that is just something that wouldn't, you know, you wouldn't happen in the real life. And I feel like, you know, right, when you remove those boundaries and those sort of social cues that we're used to in society, you get a bit more pleasure, to be honest with you. So it's good, isn't it, really?
Yeah, and you probably feel more free to do swap outs like that because it's not in person, you know? So like you kind of remove that awkwardness of that in-person suggestion or request, you know, that distance, I think, like you said, helps like break down boundaries. Did you guys see like a huge explosion in sales during COVID?
Yeah, I mean, sales did increase. And I know from, because I also write for Future Sex. So we covered like, you know, quite a few articles over the lockdown about how, you know, the industry was booming. And it was, because obviously, you know, we all have needs and we really couldn't have them catered for, could we? And I mean, there were sex workers that, you know, couldn't go to work anymore. I mean, OnlyFans went crazy, didn't it, during the lockdown? And I think that, you know, all of these sort of areas are so intertwined. And obviously there were so many couples that couldn't see each other. It was crazy. Like, you know, couples that sort of, you know, made a work trip and you know, not seen each other for a year. So yeah, we got a lot of interest. And I mean, even on the Reddit, you know, that people were asking questions during the lockdown, you know, how can this technology help? You know, I've never heard of it before, but, you know, I was recommended it. And so obviously, you know, people were searching for ways to stay connected. So yeah.
Since you brought it up a couple of times, just so people can find it, what is your Reddit?
So our Reddit is just r/Kiro. So I will give that as a link at the end, but yeah, we have our own like community on there. And there's also a user for Kiro if you want to get in touch with them, and it's just Kiro Amsterdam. But we'll make sure to get a little link.
Fantastic. So what do you think is like the next step then? Where are we in advancing the future of sex tech?
I think for me, one thing I'm really going to look out for is, I think the next step is the content side of things, like matching up your experience with the toy with content. And I mean, we've really seen that in obviously our Feel Stars campaign, because a big one in the name, we want people to feel their favorite porn star. We want people to get to know their favorite porn star. But what complements that? Well, it's obviously watching the favorite scenes of your porn star. And I think that, yeah, like POV porn, it's really advancing in a way that will really help immerse people. And I mean, for me as a woman as well, I'm quite excited to see what's going to come for that, in the future. So yeah, I think that, yeah, I think that VR is perhaps a bit inaccessible for some people at the moment, or they feel it is, just because of the cost of headsets and things like that. But, you know, like I know enough people that have had a brilliant, brilliant experience with just a mobile VR headset and a key on. So, yeah, I think that the more word gets out there, the bigger this is going to grow.
Yeah, it's interesting, right, how like technology tends to go in directions that it's hard to anticipate. I mean, I remember like 2-3 years ago, I was having meetings with people telling me that I had to get into the VR market right now. It was going to explode in the next year. And that's all porn was going to be was VR. And that hasn't happened. I mean, there's definitely like a growing interest in VR, and there's definitely VR companies that are doing well, but it didn't have like the takeover of the porn market that so many people were telling me about. And I don't know if you remember that there was like the whole 3D craze for a minute. And there was one company in particular that I knew spent like hundreds of thousands of dollars on like 3D equipment to make 3D porn, and that just sank. And they lost so much money.
Yeah, I mean, I think that it comes down to difficulties with the hardware, to be honest. Yeah. And also as well, how can VR porn take over when you've still got free porn? Literally by, you know what I mean? It's just, yeah. People aren't bothered really, are they? We always want a freebie, me included. But again, I think that we're starting to learn more about free porn. Like, I think that, for example, like OnlyFans, and sort of listening to a lot of the creators on there and why the porn industry was harming them and harming their income, it has, you know, brought a shift. And that shift will work in favor of VR. And I mean, if you're investing in sex toys, interactive sex toys, a subscription for VR porn, it's not really a bit much extra, is it? Whereas I think before, perhaps people didn't feel the need, you know what I mean? So I 100% do think it's one to look out for. And I mean, as well, we've got to think that there's a bit of a difference between like VR porn and interactive porn. So interactive porn is obviously still 2D, but it just connects with your sex toys. So, you know, giving you that interactive experience, giving you the sort of hands-free experience. And, you know, for a lot of people, I can see why that would be fantastic. I mean, if you think that there's millions and millions of people living with hand mobility issues just from something like even arthritis, interactive porn with sex tech is brilliant for them because it's obviously going to take the work from them. So, you know.
Yeah. I mean, I think if anything, what we've seen in this last year is, you know, the human desire for connection. And that's why OnlyFans has done so incredibly well. And I would imagine that that will continue on with the interactive sex toys and anything that connects people in some way or another. But it'll be really interesting to see. So thank you so much for coming on and giving us some insight into the future of sex tech. It was really interesting. Where can people find you online?
Okay, so if you want to learn anything about Kira, please do come to our Reddit. You can contact the moderator, Kira Amsterdam, and obviously check out our main site. It's just www.kira.com. We have all the stuff about our Feelstar collection. Yeah, we've done like loads of interviews with the girls. Yeah, so it's exciting stuff. Definitely come and have a look.
Fantastic. Thank you so much.
No worries.
And you guys can follow me on Twitter and on Instagram at Holly Randall. You can support this podcast by going to patreon.com/HollyRandallUnfiltered. And thank you all so much for coming. Eleanor, thank you again for your time.
No worries. Thanks for having me.
Bye.